name is Carsten Stöcker. I'm a physicist. I worked for Accenture for 30 years, did a lot of large-scale system integration projects, joined R&D, the Energy Innovation Hub a couple of years ago, and spent the last 3 years in terms of doing blockchain, IoT innovation for corporates. And today I would like to give you kind of little insights how innovation is being done in the blockchain space in corporates. Then I left Energy, founded Sphurity GmbH. I will also give you an outlook what Sphurity is doing. But I will primarily talk about corporate innovation in the blockchain space. In addition, I will also give you some insights what corporate Germany is doing in the Industry 4.0 area, in the blockchain area, and what kind of innovations we're seeing here. Yeah, I'm also working for the World Economic Forum. That's my first slide. Because World Economic Forum basically say it's all about fusion of technologies, the fourth industrial revolution. So now we have drones, we have quantum computing, blockchain, AI, tons of modern cryptography, autonomous vehicles, whatever it is. And all the innovation are coming together as a tsunami. They're all right now at the tipping point. And as a corporate, I think you cannot go for a simple incremental business case, like here's a business case for the next 50K proof of concept field test. It's really about the hypotheses, fusion of technologies, building capabilities today to play a relevant role in all these kind of technologies at the tipping point and coming to the market. And that's very important because you cannot do kind of simple business case for 50K investment. You really have to go for hypotheses to play a dominant role in the process class solution and start building capabilities today. Even some of the technologies are not fully mature. So, what did I do at Energy? So-called machine economy lighthouse. And machine economy, we combined IoT, blockchain, cybersecurity, and AI. Why did we combine this? Because so when you do corporate innovation, so then you have to kind of follow some rules, and then people ask you to start with design thinking first. And what was the first things people told me at Energy? So don't start your blockchain activities. First go to customers and ask them what the customer needs, why they need blockchain, and all those kind of things. As a response, what we developed is kind of a new perspective on customers. Because today, design thinking, we have two types of customers, people and organizations, B2C, B2B, B2B, B2C, whatever it is. But I think in the future, and we see it now with Alexa, when virtual private assistants are driving purchasing decisions, now we see that we have a third customer group that's machines, because machines are doing independent economic decisions, what transactions they are basically doing. They do physical transactions, do financial transactions, direct counterparty, peer-to-peer, and that's the machine economy. I think that's very important, that's not new, it's old concepts. In Germany, people started working on so-called cyber-physical systems 15 or almost 20 years ago. However, now with a combination of these technologies, IoT, blockchain, cybersecurity, and artificial intelligence, it's for the first time realistic that we have machines doing economic independent transactions among each other. Yeah, so corporate innovation and energy. Energy is a physical utility, and it's about combining blockchain with transactions in the physical world, and you basically do this via IoT. And the corporate world is not only energy, it's also the BMWs, the Bosches. So blockchain for them is a portfolio of decentralized technologies. It's blockchain on the one hand side, it's peer-to-peer data storage such as IPFS, ChipchainDB, a lot of peer-to-peer communication, especially in the IoT world, how to use public key infrastructure to establish secure communication among devices, and then it's modern cryptography, trusted computation, off-chain computation. So whole portfolio of these things, and it's also interesting because the McKinsey's go around and talk about two-speed IT, like legacy IT, and now more agile cloud-based IT. And if in a corporate you would like to be successful, then suddenly you have three-speed IT. You also have to build a completely entire innovation, digital, and system integration technology delivery capability for these new kinds of decentralized technologies to play a role there. Yeah. I mentioned economic independent machines. I think very, very simple experiments. Combine a machine with sensors, embedded computing, and algorithms with blockchain. And suddenly, via blockchain, the machine gets an identity, an interoperable identity that can do direct counterparty transaction. Blockchain gets a wallet, it can receive payments for services it's providing, such as transport services of people, of goods, data services, other physical services, and it can spend money for services utilizing, charging, insurance, maintenance, and suddenly each machine has a P&L, profit-loss statement. Each machine is completely economic independent, and that's the reason why we have this third group of customers, the machines. I think giving machines a P&L is not a new concept. For example, in the logistics industry, when you have a fleet of trucks, today, in your ERP system, you give each individual truck a P&L, a profit-loss statement. The big difference is, so that the truck is not economic independent yet, and that the P&L calculations most of the times are completely wrong, because then you don't know how much diesel gasoline you have in your tank of the truck, was it put at the end of the month, beginning of the month, and you don't know what was the P&L for this month. And with these types of technology, you have entire audit trails in terms of the transactions that the car, that the truck has been done, and then you can build correct profit loss statements for your machines, and that's good. Last but not least, so it's not kind of just a dream. So in corporate Germany, a lot of the big OEMs, truck manufacturing companies, are exactly exploring this use case, combining autonomous trucks with the blockchain wallet for all kinds of transactions, and also combining a blockchain with a vehicle, and that's what's being done there. And it's not a new concept, it's also old. Antonopoulos described this in this Mastering Bitcoin book. Basically, again, that forceless solution, fusion of technologies. We combine Bitcoin, Uber, or autonomous driving, and suddenly we have the self-owning car, the economic independent car, the economic independent truck, and that's changing the entire transaction systems, for example, logistics or transportation supply chains. And that's the reason why a lot of big corporates are looking into this, so not only in Germany, also around the globe, including the US automotive companies, or Toyota, and some other people. So at Innogy, to basically build something simple, charging, and it's important corporate innovation, so it's not only about technology, it's about business model, a lot of regulations and compliance. And yeah, I think it's pretty simple to say we have a car, we have a charging pole, two machines, both have a wallet, we use a blockchain, a CM smart contract to do an escrow payment, and via an escrow payment in a smart contract we can do a direct counterparty transaction among a car and a charging pole. And in addition, so the business logic in the smart contract takes out all the risks, so it's direct counterparty transactions without credit risk, because the business logic in the smart contract escrow is basically looking into or giving trust to the charging pole, there's money, it can start the energy transfer process in the car, and also gives trust to the car, because the charging pole doesn't deliver energy, then the car owner of the car can refund the escrow payment, so it's a trustless direct counterparty transaction with no credit risk. That's a very powerful concept. So in Innogy, we built a prototype with Lockit, I think 2 or 3 years ago, very easy, took the smart lock prototype, put it in a charging pole, instead of open-close the lock, the open-close, we switched on, switched off the power switch in the charging pole, read out the metering data and did some billing and settlement. That's also important for corporates, how to scale this, because going in a lab is boring, everyone's doing this. We need to scale it, to bring it to the into the field, to demonstrate it's working. And then you can use retrofitting, it's a very nice concept, because in Germany we have a very nice industrial base that's not yet fully kind of integrated with new modern technologies, but with retrofitting, you can blend in the new technologies such as blockchain, build new capabilities and prepare yourself for the technology revolution. So what does retrofitting mean here? So basically you see a fleet of charging poles, thousands of charging poles connected via a mobile communication network to a gateway in a data center. By the way, in Germany it's a fully validated, certified IT system. It's already a geeichtes IT system by the physical technical government agency. basically you can say, okay, I trust the infrastructure from the communication gateway via the mobile communication network to a charging pole. When I trust it, I can put a blockchain node next to the gateway, and in one sweep, in the retrofitting approach, has the entire fleet of charging poles on blockchain, and it delivers scale on the asset side. But this doesn't only deliver scale on the asset side to kind of to build a capability, it's also delivering a business case, because today, on top of the communication gateway, is sitting an expensive commercial backend. The commercial backend has links to banks, to roaming service providers, to other third parties. And when the physical transaction is being validated by the blockchain and the financial transaction is done instantaneously, so you basically take out the expensive commercial backend system, including manual processes to process master data and the ERP system. And in addition, so we take out the interfaces to banks, to roaming provider, and then the blockchain delivers an interoperable charging network. And that's what Energy built as well. So the product was called Share and Charge, a full digital experience. It was built with design thinking, because when you use design thinking with your kind of electric vehicle drivers, you basically find out in the first seconds they don't have Ether or Bitcoin, they would like to pay in Euro. And that's the reason it's also relevant for this crypto asset conference. This was built on the CM blockchain, but with crypto Europe. So basically going into regulations, niche regulations, if you set up a crypto Euro token on the blockchain, you can do it for one niche use case as an exception, let's say for charging. If you then would like to scale it to other verticals and use cases, you need an e-money license. So in this case was done for this niche regulation set up, financial regulations. And crypto euro and crypto euros was also then accepted by the customers who participated in using the project. I mentioned interoperability because this was also my big vision kind of to demonstrate this. And when I was with Energy, I approached kind of the Fortum, the Nexus, the ELAT, other big utilities in Europe to connect their blockchain, their charging infrastructure as well. And it's a big achievement because you put only a blockchain node to the gateway in the data center or connect an API that's being opposed. Then again, in one sweep, you have the entire fleet of charging poles on your blockchain solution. And then you can demonstrate true interoperability and show that the roaming use case is delivered by a blockchain solution. It's probably worth to mention that now was taken off the market, the Share and Charge app, because for good reason, because it's redeveloped now, because Ethereum technology is maturing, blockchain technology is maturing, and that's what's currently being done kind of to upgrade technology and also make it more fit for consortium blockchain approach and to go from the public blockchain because it's too expensive to do the transactions there. I mentioned the crypto euro. And then the last thing, that's something I started working on, and you probably saw Alexander Kullum from Brainbot. And so I'm really a big fan of peer-to-peer token streaming. Because today, it's a very exchange, so in the physical industry it's called liquid supply medium. A liquid supply medium can be energy, heat, water, gas, all kind of things. And that's a liquid, continuous stream of a physical thing. And what's not existing in payments today, it's a peer-to-peer token streaming or liquid payment stream. And basically compensate as every single micro packet of energy, and for as single micro packet of energy you send a micro token that's fully synchronized, direct counterparty peer-to-peer, that's not existing, and there are a lot of use cases in the physical world for gas, water, energy, access, time-based usage of assets, but also in the digital industry, also for access to assets or maybe streaming of media data. So there are a lot of liquid supply media. And so we basically think today that a lot of discrete payment methods, such as pre and post payment, OTC payments, flat fees, payment by installment, with certain party intermediaries, smart contract, escrows, or the adoption of this discrete payment methods, And every discrete payment method includes some complexity, includes some processing steps, might include even expensive third parties. So in VSO, I personally believe very strongly in the peer-to-peer node streaming, because with this, basically you stream energy, such as the charging example, and then you stream a token back. And how does it look like? It looks, in this rail example, pretty straightforward, because you connect the rail node to a car, to a charging pole, and then you have your direct payment channel. This is similar to the Litecoin, Bitcoin Lightning is going, but with rail, it's much more flexible. I think it's simpler because the smart contracts. It's much more flexible because you can stream any token. You can stream your ICO ERC20 token, you can stream wrapped Ethereum token, a crypto euro token. And that's what I think is a very nice innovation, basically to control the energy, the micro energy package stream from a charging pole to a car, split up into tiny packages, receive a token, and then to sync the token payment with the energy stream. Direct counterparty peer-to-peer without any complex processing logic in between and without any third parties. And I think it's a big innovation in the payment area where we see a lot of use cases in the future, especially when it comes to transactions smart machines. That's a more kind of generalization. I like this chart because it's showing, so we have the entire transaction is fully digitized. Physical transaction, financial transaction, fully digitized. So we basically say it's being done among digital twins on a decentralized platform. And the only thing what's still in place is the so-called data oracle. That's also very funny because then we have a digital twin, a digital identity, a digital autonomous agent sitting on a decentralized platform, only connected to the real world via data oracle. So data oracle then delivers authenticated data into the system. And then everything else, the digitized energy stream, the payments, the trust, the reputation, ownership transfer, so can be done on a decentralized platform. And we think that it's a very, very powerful concept that's in place. However, a lot of people are pushing this forward because not only about the data, it's putting about analytics on top of it, especially edge analytics at the machine to make it an autonomous economic agent. I think Chetnam is working on similar things. She will talk about this. There's another team, I like the team, it's Fetch AI. It's Google DeepMind, you probably know DeepMind. One of the founders founded DeepMind and sold it to Google, founded now Fetch AI. And what those people are doing is they're also combining blockchain and artificial intelligence for service discovery, for so-called learning ledger. Learning ledger where you have identities, you have trust vectors about identities, you have a context of identities, what kind of transactions have been done. And then I can start doing service discovery, like I'm a machine, I have a very unique basic need, and then I need to find a counterparty that can fulfill the need, and on such a learning ledger, you can basically do this, and it's a huge amount of innovation, including also what I like primarily is so-called useful proof of work. It's a big innovation because in Bitcoin, you basically have your hashing and you just burn energy, but if you can make sure in the proof of work for such a ledger, you do useful calculations, kind of optimize the system, aggregate assets, or personalize an experience with analytics. This is big, and that's something so we are exploring from our Sverity Digital Twin side together with the Fetch AI people. Yeah, what is Sverity? So I will give a pitch at 2 o'clock today. There are some startup pitches. It's basically bridging the spheres of the physical, biological, and digital world, providing identities in all these spheres, providing data audit threads about the identities, and allowing direct counterparty peer-to-peer transactions. And yeah, this is what's being pitched at 2 o'clock. And, I'm happy to take some questions. Do we have time for questions?
We are doing actually afterwards panel discussion with all the speakers, so please write down your questions, come back again when you have them. And now, next up is Yanislav. Yanislav, no, really happy to have you.